Why is it so difficult? I mean, why is this strong tendency to lose the present?
Oh, yes, a good question.
For me, I have like a strong tendency that something in me is like, okay, now we have to do something. Leave this present thing and let's do something. Like, so there is a tendency, a strong tendency to lose the present.
Yes, it's a very good question. Yeah. Why is there a strong tendency to lose the present? And it's the habitual nature of the ego to be continuously hooking in and having this pseudo-reality of a separate self. But one of the greatest things, I mean, there's various things. I think, like if you go to a teacher like Muji, usually what happens is if there's a calling from within, then there arises, or often there may be spiritual experiences and recognizing something which is not so limited. And then it's like from within, you could say through grace, then there's a huge spiritual, you could say a huge spiritual seeming fire or intent to release identification. And there seems to be enough willingness to, even if there's a hook, because it's like an addiction, hook, non-stop, the whole life. So there seems to be, with these spiritual awakenings or meeting spiritual teachers, or even just individual awakenings, something arises from within, shall we say, that suddenly there is the urge to unhook, even though the tendency is always back to hook, because it's such a strong tendency of hooking. So this inspiration from within gradually means that even though the hooking seems to be automatic, you know, some power or some teaching or some mechanism is given to unhook immediately, or someone meets a teacher which teaches how to unhook, or is led to certain books which teach the release. But in the beginning it can be very strong, the tendency to re-hook into a thought, re-hook into the body, re-hook into feelings, you see, and not to immediately unhook, even if this hook. Now, that's why it's like that in the beginning. In my own story, there was kidney failure, because I was working in the stock market in a very unspiritual life. And then, you know, facing death, and then there was a spiritual experience in the hospital bed. You know, the moment to surrender, and the spiritual message to find a spiritual solution. So then the spiritual journey started, but that facing death, physical death, and then having a spiritual, timeless spiritual experience, there was like something in the universe suddenly brought the right teachers after that experience. It was all became correlated. And then the teachers were teaching, you could say, unhooking. And there was, so I got introduced to Hawkins and Muji more or less at the same time, my two teachers, who both teach different mechanisms of unhooking. Yeah, Muji incorporated. So it's like from within, and then the teachers come from without, and the teachings come from without. Then it's like from within, there is a great willingness to unhook. So in the early days, it's difficult, because the tendency is like a bad habit. It's like...
it's how it feels, like a bad habit.
It's a very bad habit, and the tendency is just to latch. Yeah. But, you know, with each day of practice, and if there's the spiritual fire from within to keep doing it, it becomes easier and easier. And things like being in the presence of a spiritual teacher are very useful. Also, my spiritual teacher, Dr. Hawkins, recommended doing the lessons from A Course in Miracles, which I did. I did and still do every day now. I don't know what it is, 8-9 years.
Yeah.
But, you know, roughly, because he said, and A Course in Miracles, apart from many things, taught me discipline. And...
maybe I should buy the book and do it.
You know, and I've had many people, and they don't often keep it, you know. This is probably like my, because I've been having this watch for so long. I mean, this is probably my 6th or 7th watch, because straps keep breaking. But I always buy the same watch now, Casio.
6th, 7th?
Yeah, 7th watch, because the straps keep breaking. But I have to buy this watch, because, you know, God told me this is the watch that will set me free.
Oh,
this watch. And because you can set it to beep. It's adjustable alarms. So like, you know, you can have every hourly, or every 50 minutes, or every 40 minutes, or every 30 minutes,
okay.
Or every 10 minutes. And I found it to be quite a mystical thing in my experience. So it was like, not only did I have my teachers of enlightenment, I had this watch, because the habitual tendency for the ego to rehook into the world is very strong. And it's like, it's easy to rehook one thought. It just takes one thought and you're hooked.
Yeah, and then
you're lost for maybe day, you know, hours, or many hours, you're in the hooking. So it's like, but then it's like this watch suddenly goes beep, 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 and you go, oh.
The presence alarm.
Presence alarm, exactly.
That's a good one.
It's not a bad idea.
Presence alarm. And
I have to put it, you know, every 5 minutes.
I have mine on every 5 minutes.
Oh,
every 5 minutes. And it was really, and I still have it on 5 minutes for a long time now. But in the beginning it was like hourly.
Mm-hmm.
And the ego, my experience was the ego had such resistance to decreasing the time. Each time the time, but at a certain point it was like the spirit said, I'm ready for a presence alarm more regularly to make progress. And the ego is like upset that I can't be in hooking for a whole hour before I have to unhook. And then it was like, you know, every half an hour. And then it was like there was more presence, because one was unhooking from identification with the world every time the alarm went. And then it was like every 20 minutes. And then even 20 minutes was quite long, you see. So now we're ready for 10 minutes. And then 5 minutes. And then it just totally disrupts the need to hook into the world. It becomes even, it's almost like reversing. So it's like you stay in presence, you forget to even go into the world and hook in. You just stay in the timeless presence. So this is one of the mechanisms, because it's a good question, you know, the habitual tendency to rehook. Because it's very simple, you see.
Yeah.
Very simple. But just the first hook is enough, it's finished. Hook into any thought, any physical symptom, and that's it. You know, you're re-identified in the world. So eventually then, with that, then like Muji, which is advanced, becomes much easier, you see, because then you can employ the regularity of the alarm with self-inquiry, you see. So the two then, you know, because those are my two teachers. You know, Hawkins recommended A Course in Miracles, his own teachings, and Muji recommends self-inquiry. So then eventually you start to get, you know, self-inquiry then is like, becomes on steroids, you see, because you're constantly inquiring what's observing. See, how do I identify myself? Am I the body? Am I like trapped in this location? Am I a thought? Or, for example, if I was to meet someone and there was identification, but what's observing me and the other person? Is that identified with either of the people? So you just unhook from everything, and then you unhook from the world. So it's like, I think, you know, Dr. Hugh Len, this guy, this mystic who cleared out of prison, he called it cleaning. And you're just cleaning away all identifications with the internal ego and the external world. Nothing there, no hook.
Mm-hmm.
Cleaning all hooks, every imaginable hook.
Mm-hmm.
And in that one becomes, you know, the truth.
Yeah.
And that has great power. People don't understand, to be in the truth, no identification has great, great power. Is where all the miracles happen. So hence the thing. So usually for an early spiritual seeker, it is very you know, unhooking, because immediately they hook. Mm-hmm. And then one of the biggest things, the easiest, and one of the biggest things is, like, if you're in the present moment, in the eternal presence, is if any thought arises with interest, the start of that thought, as soon as you hook into it, that's gone. Because usually the thought is like, I've arrived, I don't have to do anymore, I can relax, or I have to work hard. But as soon as you identify with that thought, that's it, that's re-identification, you see. Any thought is re-identification. Yeah. Because usually the thoughts are like clever, and they seem like, maybe if you didn't do it right, that's it, that's a thought. Or I should be happy now because I did it perfectly.
Yeah.
That's a thought as well. So at a certain point, so later on, if you keep unhooking, you start to realize that greater happiness and peace seem to be there, and you'll find that what's called a flow state starts to happen throughout the day. Yeah.
My dinner with me. Is it okay if I have it here? Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think I have everything I need. It's okay. Sure. Mm-hmm. Of course. Yeah.
So it's like the flow state starts to happen.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. You know, it was when I was saying, you know, remember, like a few weeks ago, my experience I had. So basically, it was a period of 1 year and a half in which I was without job and without medicine, many people. So I didn't have many things to hook into.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I entered that state. But then I entered the wall again. So, so I know that experience of subjectivity, of not hooking for a long period of time.
Exactly.
So that's really significant, because if you are present for a period of time, you start
it becomes automatically flow.
You become more settled.
Mm.
Settled in
the presence.
Yeah, settled in the presence.
So
that's to understand that that's also here now, in the middle of London, with managers.
Mm.
That's really a state of no hooking and subjectivity. But unhooking and subjectivity also can occur in London. Unhooking and
slightly harder, but it's that's the ultimate, really, I think. Anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it's the thing of what's not. If there's any pre-existing hooks within the consciousness, then it's seemingly harder in London. So it's easier with trees and rabbits. You see, to be in the flow state, but Londoners running around. But I also, you know, it's like when I'm in that state, if I walk in Oxford Street, it's total peace and silence, and it's blissful. You know, there's nothing, all the noises are very muffled in the distance, because you're not hooking into anything in the middle of Oxford Street. So this is the thing of hooking or tracking or identification or anything being meaningful. Nothing is meaningful. Everything is equal, you see. So there's flow. Because as soon as there's meaning, there's like a duality, separation. So that state, and that's the reason you're here, you see. Because it's like wanting to return home to the flow. See, something brings, if one is in a place like this, something wants to return. Like, hooking is too much hard work. Too much stress. But stress is created by hooking.
Yeah, definitely, that's clear to me. Because you start hooking and you become stressed.
Fear, anxiousness, lots of thinking, lots of future, past, existing. Troubles and problems existing. So it's hard work, you see. So it's better to do the seeming work, pretend work of unhooking all the time in the beginning, but it's unhooking from insanity, unhooking from untruth, unhooking, because not to unhook is just to stay in continuous unconscious hooking all the time. you see. That's why it seems, in the beginning it seems to be conscious, and it may seem to be like work, or one may seem to have alarms,
yeah,
or something, presence alarms, to unhook. But then eventually in the flow state becomes natural, eventually. So sometimes I'm in the flow state in Oxford Street, you see, because there's nothing hooked. All the hooks are taken, all the people running around, the noises, no unhooking. So this is just a habitual state. This becomes a normal. So it's just the thing of I always share the story of traffic noise or my tube line. Just because there is a physical phenomena doesn't mean there needs to be hooking into that phenomena. So for one person, they can hear like cars going past. Another person, they don't hear anything in the street. So just because someone says a noise is here, or somebody says feelings are here, for another person, nothing is here. Nothing even happened. You know, it's like in this room, nothing happened. There was just peace and silence and stillness. And there was not even separate people in the room, you see. That does not even exist. So, all of this can only exist with identification or tracking. And the more tracking and identification, the more resistance, and the more feelings, and the more thinking. So, it's like, now when the flow state happens, then in the flow state, everything happens, but there's no separate person then. There's no separate person. There's like, in the flow state, there's no Sabir here. See, talking can happen, but no one is talking. Or walking can happen, but no individual is walking. Everything just happens in the flow, as in the oneness, in the unfolding of creation. So there's no individuality in that. It's just everything is spontaneously arising in the field of oneness. So that's the flow state. So it's just in the beginning, it's a good question. It's just unhooking is necessary in the beginning. But in your case, a bit different, because if it's just protecting. That's what the course lesson for today, you know, not forgetting to stay in. Not forgetting to stay in the silence, in the presence,
yeah,
in the flow state. Don't hook, just stay.
Sorry.
Stay.
Okay.
Just stay in the flow state. You see. So that is the formula. Or like, because there's really nothing to do. It's just a habitual tendency to identify.
Yeah.
You see. Otherwise, if you're in the flow state, you wouldn't even have to de-identify. You just remain in the thing. But what happens actually is the ego has unconscious existing identifications. So like, if the manager walks into the room, there can be flow, and then it seems like suddenly the flow is gone and the manager is there, and it's like, oh, there's me and there's the manager, and what does the manager think? So this was the immediate identification with the scene, and creates the meeting. Immediately it seems like there's a person relating to another person. There's not the flow of oneness, timeless state. So then, you know, one has to unhook. Usually in the beginning one has to unhook a few times, and then one recognizes all being observed, no need to hook. And then eventually the manager comes in and there's no hooking, you see, it doesn't stop the flow state. So that hook has been fully released or transcended or released. So always, if there's a hook, you see, but is eventually getting to the observing of, there is an observer which cannot be hooked, because hooking means there had to be interest, in something. But if there's no interest in anything, then the flow state stays and cannot can never be unhooked. Because everything is equal, everything is meaningless. It's like, it'd be like somebody saying, every time I see a red pillow, I lose flow. It's ridiculous. Well, what's a red pillow? Why are you losing the flow for a red pillow? Unless someone says blue pillows. You know, I'm in flow, everything is natural, there are rabbits and trees, but then when the blue pillow, somebody shows me a blue pillow, then suddenly I'm in fear and I'm thinking a lot. But it's an object. If there's no identification or pure observing of the object, no blue pillow or red pillow. Like some people say it's a red pillow, some people say I lose, you know, I become disturbed when a blue pillow comes, some say a red pillow, but these are equally unimportant to it. So each individual says, no, you know, red pillows do not disturb me, but blue pillows do, and some people say blue pillows disturb me, but not red pillows. But in the true state, this is all equally nothing, and there's no identification with blue or red pillows. So objects, thought, each thought, this is like one of the first lessons. All my thoughts, it says in A Course in Miracles, are meaningless. Every thought is equally meaningless. There's no thought, it's like, but this thought is so important. No, this is also meaningless. But this, all of them are meaningless, but this thought is very, very important. It's like, no, that's also equally meaningless. So forget it. Then one gets into the flow, you see, because it's like identification with thought was another trouble a lot of people have, or identification with the body, or identification with feelings. So something is not identified and can never be identified with any of this, and is here now, you see. So this is the great joy of disidentifying from things. So when, you know, and it's great if you're in the flow state, then, you know, things will usually grace will naturally bring things which still can identify you, just to check, you see. As soon as you're in the flow, you know, If you're afraid of tigers, you know, a tiger will appear. And see, it's okay with rabbits and trees, but then suddenly, like, I don't, you know, so it's like, no, but even that, there's a disidentification. But that these different objects are different, there can be different thoughts. Some thoughts can have special significance and can seem to break the presence. No thought is meaningful. All the thoughts, when all the thoughts in the mind are equally meaningful, then the truth is recognized. None of it is important. You see, everything that I'm saying is meaningless, it's unimportant. When all of it is equally unimportant, then the truth is recognized. It wasn't important. None of it is important.
What is the truth? What is the truth?
The truth is the recognition of that is experienced when all meaning and projected meaning and all identification internally, i.e. the body, thoughts, feelings within, and all objects and meanings and projections externally are released, then that is an experience of the identification of the eternal truth, which is always here. So it's not... It can never be recognized through the intellect. It can never be recognized through thinking about it. It can never, you know, these will always, because that's thought identification.
I was reading something the last 2 days. I was reading a book, and then this person who wrote the book said that a person who meant a lot to him was Lester Levinson. I thought, who is Lester Levinson? Because into so many things through my whole life. And that, but do you really know who is Lester Levinson? So I googled Lester Levinson. Do you know what?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's the Jewish guy in the
frame. He's the man who created the Sedona.
Oh, okay.
I've heard about psychology, I looked into it a little bit, but I never really practiced it or anything. But I've heard about it a little bit, see what I saw what it was about. But then, so I googled Esther Levenson, and then I found that there are not very many YouTube videos of him, very few, but I found, I don't know how I came onto this site, and it was just from some type of book, probably, it was just his story. And I just started to read, I'm not even gone through with it. I don't even know, it must be from some book where he tells his life story. I don't know how much you know about it, but it was actually touching me because it was, so he, when he was 42 years old, he was very successful in every way, financially and also with people, relationships, but he was sick, physically sick. So he had several heart attacks, and then the doctor said to him that, when he was 42, the doctor said to him, well, you're staying in the house, you better go home and you rest. He shouldn't even bend over and tie his shoelaces because he was so weak. So he said, basically, don't do anything. And he said, for how long? Well, you might live 2 months or 2 years, but there's not much more I can do. So he thought, it was like he had nothing left to lose. And I think it's often like that, even with Jesus or anyone. These people who create, they don't set out. It's like some people say Jesus didn't set out to create Christianity. They are just finding, they know something, they find something, and then that becomes some kind of method or religion or something. For he, when he was in that state, he was sitting there in his apartment, wherever, he couldn't do it. He just advised to basically not do anything, just rest. And he thought, okay, first he thought, oh, do I have enough pills in my medicine cabinet to kill myself if I choose to? And he realized he had, and then he thought, okay, that's an option. Then he felt a bit better, than he thought he could somehow kill himself. He was like, okay, I have an option, I can decide if I want to die. But then he decided, okay, so he was a very intelligent person. He had several degrees, I think he's very scientifically minded. So he thought, okay, I have nothing to lose, so I will just. And I think that's often what happens with these people, then it becomes some kind of method that other people try to imitate it, or like, but the person who finds it is because they have let go of all the teachings and stuff. And I just decide, okay, I'm going to look. So he said, I'm going to look what's going on here, what's it all about, what's going on with me. So he started to ask himself, like, what is life about, what is happiness, and he just like from scratch, and he had been very also like academic, I think in scientific, he had a big library, so first few days he just started to read lots of stuff, and then oh no, this is not giving me anything like Jung and Freud, and he already knew all this stuff, I'm going to let go all this bullshit, I'm not going to go in this down, and then he felt a kind of a liberation to let go of all that intellectual knowledge. And then he just, so I was really touched. I was reading at 1:30 in the morning. I was sitting late in the dark reading this thing. So he started to ask himself, what is happiness? And then, so first he thought, oh well, it is to be loved. But then he started to think, I've been loved, I am. Am I loved now? Yes, I'm loved. Many people truly love me, and it doesn't make me happy. So, okay, so it's not, that's not it. But then I started to think, well, have I ever been happy? Yes, I have. So what moments were those? When was I happy? And he remembered certain moments when he was happy, and then he thought, what was the common denominator of these moments? And he realized it was more like he had been loved. He had loved. He had felt love. He didn't feel love, but he felt love. So that was something that I felt love. I felt love, and that made me happy. But anyway, also then it was like, I think that's what it's about a lot, because he started to go back into his life and remember moments when he felt upset, so he realized he could choose, because at that moment he was very upset with the doctor, and because he thought they had just given up on him, said go home, he was angry with the doctor, so okay, can I change this feeling? For a feeling of love for the doctor, and he realized he could switch it around, he could kind of choose to feel differently. So he did that with many occurrences in his life. He went back to occurrences when he had felt very angry or upset, you know, because he was very physically sick, so the more he did this, the more he felt suddenly he was healed by just changing this. But what was even more interesting, so after he had done that, he got happier and happier, just sitting by himself doing this, and then how far can I take this? And he just said, I feel so happy all the time, I feel happier than I ever felt. But then there was like, he could feel that it was like a step, he could step. It was like there was something beyond that, and there was this peace. That, because he felt it was, in a way, you could feel super happy, it was almost exhausting to be that happy all the time. And there was like, he felt if I could just take this little step into this, and I would be in this peace, and it would stay with me forever. And this is just, I mean, I don't know who wrote this story, but it was like, always a written story, but it was very touching to read for me, at least. So then he kind of said, okay, and I took that step, and I felt this complete peace, and it didn't depend on anything, like often, like I heard you say, it was this thing, it's nothing about relationships, not about money, not about anything, and he said, I knew that this is beingness, this is the essence of life, this is the essence of beingness, this is the essence, this peace, it is the essence of everything. And I am the same as everyone. And when I read it, I was sitting there in the dark in the room because my friend, and he was sleeping in the bed, so I'm sitting in the dark, and I thought, I hope he doesn't realize I'm sitting, I'm still reading in the dark. And then I could feel this interesting thing, I felt like, almost like, I felt, yeah, I know, I mean, I haven't experienced what he experienced, but I know, when I read it, I felt like, I know what he means, because often, even when I talk about it, I can feel there is this beingness always that I can somehow feel. And that is something that is, I cannot even talk pinpoint what it is. It's something like, there is something here that is the beingness. And when I read that, I thought, this is what I am and this is what everything is. And I felt almost like terror, almost. I thought, shit, if I am everything and everyone, I felt this extreme loneliness, because there's no other, everything is me, and it's only me, and I felt this fear, I felt this terror, like God, it's just, and this is what it is, it's just me, all of this is just me, and I was terrified, no, I don't want
if I was there, I'd push you in there.
You see where I'm going, it's terror, it's all me, it's just different facets of me, and it's all kind. Oh no, I don't want to do this illusion, I can pretend to someone else, I can relate to. And it was horrifying, actually, this feeling of, you know what I mean?
You missed your chance.
Yeah. You missed your chance.
It's like the absolute, the rest, there's like
exactly.
One.
Exactly, loneliness,
it's like,
on the contrary, it's peace. It's like you don't need anything from outside. It's not a sense of lack at all.
You traded
it for romantic visions. eternal peace forever. No, I want to be. I have my fantasies. I want to trade eternal peace and happiness. If God offered it to you, you'd go, no thank you God, I want drama.
You don't want to.
There's something
there. More drama sometimes.
There's something.
The end of drama and fantasy.
You might often, I can feel, often I sense it, think of it, just not even think, it's not the right word. When I direct my focus towards this, I kind of sense this beingness, I don't know what you call it, I just sense that this is what,
but
it's almost like this, what is this? What is this? What is going on? And I can feel this, there is something here, that's all I know. Something is here and it's alive, there's something here being, there's some beingness. And that beingness, when he said, and that is not, it's almost like it's only one beingness, there's not just one beingness.
Do you want to be the beingness, or do you want to be the thing that talks about the beingness forever?
It's not the fact if I want to be. I want to be it or not.
If you were it, you wouldn't be talking like you're talking.
Yeah, but I am worried because I'm terrified. I felt that in the night in my sitting room.
You are the
oh my God, it's all me.
That's why you're not in eternal peace.
Yeah, that's
right. You want your fantasy.
What was this? That would happen. Then I felt this terror, actually.
And this terror thing, like similar to what Sabir was sharing about the terror of death, because sometimes the self, it can seem like it's just going to swallow you, like, you know.
It feels like there's,
there's just me,
and that's all. It's not
God, the identity. That's it. Finished.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm trying, but maybe it was a complete identification with the ego. That's what
You've been here enough times. You know it's the death of that. It's in the dying of that and the facing of the last fear.
But there was a great... Then he even said also that he realized that he had a great fear. One thing that stopped him was the fear of death. And then even that, he just kind of faced it. And then he was laughing. As he said, I just laughed at it. And he came to this point where he felt complete peace with everything. And just for me, just reading about these things for me is very... I love to read about
You love
things,
to read, but not to die.
I don't read often these days. I used to read a lot, I don't do that.
Maybe God brought you here.
That's
you know.
Good. That's great.
God's like giving you a book. You got to die.
God.
You go to a group. You got to die. Now I'm going to read another book.
I rarely read these days.
It sounds a very interesting book. What's the book is called?
I don't know what the book is called because I found it.
Okay.
I was looking for a Sinimsa and then I came to some web page about him and then I started reading. It was all
God directs
you
to
do
that
thing. Yeah.
Let's leave
it to me. If you want, I can send you a link.
No,
to the page.
You've got the tapes. Can you let it go? Will you let it go when? Yeah?
Do you want
it? Oh, yeah. No, I just love his story.
Okay, so that's the story. It's very
and it's really touching deep there, I must say. It is.
That's right, yeah, that's what. I think Sabir wants you to want you to accept, you know, the death of me instantly. It takes time, Sabir, okay? She takes, you know.
Let's talk about
it.
Let's talk about it for a few more years.
It's okay. Some of us get, you know, take baby steps.
Some of us,
you know, run, and some of us, you know,
we did a Course in Miracles about our function today. I mean, it's the function of the Course in Miracles to talk about it.
That's it,
for
exactly.
For all eternity. Let's talk about letting the ego go. It's very entertaining to talk about it. Probably read another 20 books about how entertaining it is to let go of the cause of...
Oh, what do you say? Don't want to be like...
That's better.
Oh my God, that was quite an amazing kind of, you know, God experience. I think that God directly... I love the story of this.
It was an amazing
story.
I'll just quote it for you. I love his story. It is a wonderful story, actually. Very touching story. Beautiful. But also, just from him experiencing, I think, okay, that is the truth. I believe what he's saying, so that makes me think, okay, that is the truth. So even if I don't experience it now, it doesn't matter, because that is the truth.
Do you want to experience it now?
But you are experiencing it now.
You have to. Yes, I might have better leave that. It doesn't matter.
God bless you.
Your truth is experience. I mean, you don't experience the truth. It's like...
It's like a beautiful strawberry. Look at it, but you're not tasting it.
I know it's tasty.
It's like...
Yeah, because I know I will eat. At some point I will eat. It's like you have a nice food and you don't say it. Okay, then no. I will eat it. But I don't eat it today. It doesn't matter because I know it's there. No.
All right. So eat it one day in the future. In the, not today.
Oh, yeah,
in the future. At some point in the future, I will taste it.
Don't you see the difference from a person? They don't even see the fruit, they don't even know it's anything. But if you know, you have, it's like you have a nice meal on a taste.
Well, you've got to save it for the tomorrow. Let's talk about saving it for tomorrow. let's everyone discuss about saving it for tomorrow. Let's read a few more stories about it as well. We'll keep it for tomorrow, for all eternity.
For all eternity.
Tomorrow I'll be eternity.
Tomorrow I'll be free. In the beach. Are there some good books we can read until tomorrow? why spiritual seekers never get invited.
Oh my God.
Number one, they need to read another story.
It was so close to it.
I would say it for tomorrow.
Thank you for bringing so much laughter.
Exactly.
So now in this moment, yeah, we talked about that eternal presence.
Yeah.
Is it here now?
It's always there.
No, I mean, is that your...
She's saving it for tomorrow.
if I'm this moment, same as in the night this morning.
Yeah.
No, if I kind of just turn my attention to this moment.
Good, yes.
I feel the presence of something that is the beingness in the moment. I can, any time, I think I can just, if I just switch my focus, I can feel this.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that, I don't know what it means. It isn't particularly happy or joyful to me. It's just like something that I cannot define, really. I just feel there's something here. That's the only thing I can actually be sure of, really, if you ask.
Good.
So there's something that is here that is present. There's some kind of presence, that's what I would call it. Presence that is not, and it's scary to me a little bit, because it feels like it's not really, maybe that's why I'm misinterpreting it, I don't know what. Because for me, I remember once many years ago when my uncle's, I don't know what it's called in English, but my uncle's wife, she died suddenly from a car accident. And I know my father said to me, oh, my, this woman, she's dead now. She was just, it was in the winter in Sweden, they were driving on the highway and there was a car coming from the other, it was just from the ice, she was just wearing over to the other lane and they were just killed like that. She was killed. And I remember when I saw that, my father told me, and I was sitting in Gothenburg in the student's home, and I remember I was just looking outside when I got this information, and I saw these trees outside. Bare trees in the winter, I saw them. And I just felt, and I feel it's a bit, little bit the same feeling I get when I turn towards this person, this feeling of this beingness, these trees, this beingness is there, and you can get some information like somebody, because something that is dramatic for a human being is like, oh my God, you know, it's like horrible. But for this beingness, it's like, it just all about, it doesn't affect the beingness, the beingness doesn't care, it doesn't kill, it was like, so I don't know if I kind of, for me it's like something with, it's not emotionally involved in that way that a human being is. I just feel it's like something that's present, and no matter what is happening, it is just there like some kind of still, neutral, I don't know what he, maybe I'm completely, maybe it cannot be the same thing he's talking about, because for me it's not about, it feels just like a neutral, almost scary beingness that is not humanly involved in things like a human being is like. And so when I turn towards it, I just feel like something here that will just be present. Whatever is happening, it is. And when he said in his text, like, this is what I am, there is this peace. But he felt it like a immense peace, so he said, I felt this peace, and I am this peace, and it is the essence, when he said it's the essence of everything, then I felt that touched me very deeply, because I felt some kind of truth in that, that yes, I know, I felt almost like, I know there is something that is the core essence of everything, and that something is something that is not this up and down, blah, 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 you know, all the drama.
Yes.
It's something else, and it's always there, and it's still, and it doesn't care, and that sounds harsh and scary to me. It kind of doesn't care about the drama. And I don't, what I cannot get, understand, is how that can be the same as a kind of piece that sounds like something
well,
wonderful. But for me, it's not wonderful, it's just like, impersonal and still, but not.
Well, for you to get there, you have to die. Your ego has to die. The drama, the addiction to the drama, and the also the projections of what it must be and must not be, the guarantees as well.
What is it when I feel this thing? Is it just my human projection?
No, it's partial, because you have so many projections and identifications within the ego. You're getting a subtle imprint of it, but it's not 100%.
No, so to me it's so terrifying.
It is terrifying to the ego. And you are speaking as the ego. What is terrified? That terror is being observed.
I suppose it's because I want this human caring thing.
You want the fantasy. You want the fantasy of your fantasy projections to be true, and for life to unfold like a Disney movie. and so you're not willing. You want to say, I will only let go if you guarantee that it plays like this movie, you know, this gushy movie. And so you would and the gushy movie, you've been trying the gushy movie your whole life. So it's like, for you, that's partial. You know, there's what's called like the flat, unattached observer. This is not 100% the way, but you need to at least go halfway before you can go full way, you see. Because you're at the moment, you're an ego.
So
right now, what's the experience?
Right now,
good. Okay, so in the experience of not knowing, is it like a not knowing experience? Nothingness? Is it nothingness? Beyond thoughts.
Yeah, I don't know how to define it. I don't know.
Okay, so it's intangible. Does it have a dimension? Is it like everywhere? Is it located?
I mean, it is an experience of this moment.
Okay,
I mean,
good. Good. So if you stay in that, and if any fear or any thought arises, you stay in that, that'll start to dissolve the habitual identifications. If fear or terror arises, or projections or drama starts to arise, you stay in that, or you just be in that which is watching that without interest. And then all the ego will dissolve off, you see. Otherwise, if every time a thought arises, you want to hook in and make a big long story, anything about the past, anything about the future, anything about a story, I need this big story to happen in the future, all of this, you just drop it. Then there'll be a sinking of layers. For many spiritual seekers, it doesn't go all the way in one go. You're unpeeling various layers, so you may have a period where it's like there's a mourning of not being in the drama. You know, it may feel a bit flat for a while because there's like a habitual addiction to drama, up and down, tomorrow, in the past,
to feel something.
Yeah, so it can experience, because of the lack of drama, it can experience like flat or quite unemotional for a period, but this is the halfway. So you stay in that, and then eventually this latent hooking for wanting drama, wanting to be in tomorrow, wanting excitement, wanting some story to be there, eventually it will start to die away, and then it will sink deeper into the eternal love, the eternal peace, the eternal life, and the eternal bliss.
Yeah, because I've noticed for myself just in the last couple of years since I came to London, how I've changed in the way that, oh my God, I wanted all these things, I was very... But now I cannot... I wasn't even sure if that was bad or good. I mean, I thought maybe I'm just giving up, you know, a little bit. But I felt many things I really wanted was very important. It's just like, you know, you feel like, no, it's not... You know that it won't give you what you want anyway, so I kind of feel much more that, and I think, but then you think, why do you even live in this physical, a little bit like, am I giving up on life? That's a little bit how I sometimes feel. Am I just giving up on life because I'm not really, you know, you're not as driven towards wanting things in the physical
world. You need to be in a spiritual group, we'll tell you that's a phase. You know, it's like when the ego has all the toys taken away from it, there is a phase where the ego says, unconsciously, what's the point? If I'm not chasing something...
Yeah, if I'm not chasing
drama,
things in this physical world, why would I live at all?
Yeah, so you know, for you, that's why you have certain books and certain groups you go to. Something from you deeper within says you must... You get the information that this is only a stage.
Yeah, because you read about other people, like now for him, then you read and think, okay, you see there is something.
It's, you know, like you say to me, I say, this is a stage. If the ego is upset, it's like, if there's no drama, if there's no chasing, if there's no stories, if there's no future, what's the point?
If you don't want the things that everybody wants, like everybody's everybody's running after something, everybody wants all this, and then you're like, oh, you don't want these things anymore, like if you ever wanted them, but at least now
but
you definitely don't.
You would never have come to a group like this or read a book like that if there wasn't something deeper than just a lifetime of chasing things in the ego, you see. Something wants to stay in the ego, the ego is addicted to drama and to
because
be
he doesn't
the
know anything else, right? He just wants to survive.
He wants to say it's not the truth. It's suffering.
When you read these stories, I mean, when we hear, I just feel the truth of it. I mean, that's why it touches me, of course, because you read it, you feel like, shit, it just touches you. I can start to cry sitting there by myself because it just touches
but,
me. So
but
weird.
It's like there's a deeper point to it just being a story and just continue rereading the story and being touched by it. It
yeah, but I mean, you are touched by it because you feel there's a truth.
There's a truth, but then the ego tries to hijack it into into. Oh, let's make a big story about it and talk about it.
Okay.
And let me. How many times can I read this book so that I can read the drama and then look.
So there's
a bit,
the drama.
Little bit of. It feels good. And let me read it again and re-identify. So there's a deeper point to it, so that you can be free, you know. So the thing with that is, if you rest in just being here now, like you said, presence. In the presence, in the eternal presence. There's no complication.
Because it's always there, you don't have to go anywhere else, it's always in the moment.
It's
you, that's the paradox.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the
who
real
you.
You
are the beingness, and who you are is the source of love that you feel, that you call emotion and feeling, and who you are is that light. That's the
that
paradox.
That I never got. I mean, I've heard you hear it said, but I have never really.
No, because you can't.
You're,
the
you
imagination,
have to
you hold on to the imagination,
yeah.
So the imagination
you need to defrost
real.
A bit more in the now.
Yeah.
It's a real paradox.
There can often be a phase of like something feeling deprived of drama and being the future and the past, so it's a bit flat for a while. But if you just stay in the presence, eventually that will die off. It's like a false baby crying because it has no toys. And then eventually the baby stops crying and the baby stays silent, and then eventually the love is there. It's like defrosting, but because it's like won't let go, no, it takes the drama back immediately. Oh, it was present for a moment, let me take the drama back.
That's what you use.
And then it goes, okay, it's better now, I have the drama back.
Yeah.
But you have to let the drama be gone for a while, and then it will dissolve into the love, because it's like thawing out the layers. Because the focus is too much in identification, in drama. It's like it has to like thaw out, and then, because this is an illusion. When you go into drama, you have drama, 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 a little bit of love, and then drama, 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 little
but
bit of
love. That's what I want sometimes when they say, oh, you're this love, and this is love. Because this kind of person's little feeling I get of it, it's not really love, it's just...
It's a glimpse
it's
of...
It's not love, it's just some kind of beingness, that it's not love. But love for me is more emotional, I suppose. The love with me is something more emotional. But this thing is not emotional at all, it's just
No, the love you feel in your emotions is the love that's here in the present moment. No, it's the same. It's more intense, even better than the love you feel from attachments.
So one thing I'm thinking while you're talking, I don't know if it's that useful advice, but my impression is that you see the beingness as something flat, you know, which is death, and I can tell you that it's not the case. It's really beautiful. So if you compare the state of beingness with the drama, the beingness is much better if you want to. It's not something like flat, no, on the contrary, it's like really deep, beautiful.
Well, it feels like it's not emotional at all. When you call what is love, then I think, what is love? What is love? What is love? What is love? What is love?
You've heard me share about the experience of addiction and attachment.
Yeah, well, you call this white light experience, all these things you call. But
no, I talk about the addiction to donuts.
Yeah, that you talk about.
Yeah, or the addiction to romantic relationships. It's the same thing. It's ego drama, inflation, fantasy. And then as the ego gets the thing it wants, it shuts up for 5 seconds. And there's an experience of love, and then there's an addiction or an attachment to an external object being the source of love. So the love that you've experienced, the best love you've experienced, in brief moments, you would experience non-stop, even better,
yeah, exactly,
all the time.
So it's not a flat thing, it's just love.
It's just the experience of eternal love, presence, happiness, and joy.
But when I switch my attention towards this kind of being in a second, in any moment, I can feel that is not the same at all as when I feel love somehow. It's more
because you're so identified with the drama. You have to give it some time before you can get the love as a constant state from within, because your consciousness is now too much external focus, too much hooked into everything. That's why you're blocked off. It'll take time for you. May not take much time, it can be happened very quickly. But the moment the identification with drama, with stories, with future, past, all of this, so you're not getting a direct connection immediately. But the flatness will dissolve.
Yes. It was also scary to me when it's not the first time in your life, but I mean that, like, everything, I am everything, it's all me, and like, oh my god, it's all me. It's like,
it's
just one thing, there's only me, and felt this extreme loneliness somehow.
That's an idea you're having, it's the same as fear, this thing's coming up, but you are... Let's say that the oneness is here and fear arises, like a fear arises as an object in it.
As loneliness
for a while, and then passes away, and then flattened, then some thoughts emerge in it, and then they pass away. But you are always here. You can forget this stuff. This stuff was never you.
Yeah. All the thoughts are just thoughts.
And the fears are just objects.
All the thoughts.
Yeah, the thought. It's also, you could say, it's a type of thought.
Yeah, it's a type of thought. It's a type of thought, isn't it?
So you're so addicted to these thoughts that you're not willing to let them go or experience, let them pass through. Because when they come up, you have to hook in. It's like you have to believe it and hook in and not experience it passing through and then realizing it was nothing.
You immediately give it meaning.
Yes.
This is true. This is it.
So immediately, you know, the last bit, terror and fear and... Oh, the terror of my separate me is going to vanish, or blah blah blah, or loneliness, or this is all. But you just don't identify. You let it come up and bubble, and then you see it didn't matter.
It's, because there's something else that is more real, that it will always be there.
Yeah, you recognize that when this last hook is gone, you don't identify. You let it pass, and you see that the truth is still here.
But then, that is true. There's nothing you can do to fail. There's no way you can ever fail, because whatever you do, the truth is always there. You can do whatever shit you want for as long as you want, and then it will always be there anyway. So that you can do what you want, because you cannot fail. You cannot mess it up. There's no point. There's no way.
But you can
experience in the truth.
No, it doesn't matter. You will experience it sooner or later. I mean, it doesn't matter if whatever you want to do, you can't destroy the truth.
You want another 500 years of drama.
Yeah, you can have another 500 years of drama. But I mean, isn't that different? Because you know that if you want another 500 years,
that's saving you and depriving you of your infinite.
Oh, it's no way to deprive it, because it's always there. It's just a game, isn't it?
It can only happen when there's readiness for it. You know, otherwise the addiction to drama is too.
But for
too
me, it's like an amazing thought, just that. Let's talk about it now. I found a new thing to talk about.
Let's switch the subject, even better.
But I think
it's such a release for me to just have
That's fine.
I know there's nothing I can do to destroy it. There's nothing I can do to mess it up. I can delay it if I want, What does it matter?
If I want to
delay it another 5 years, what does it matter? Time is just an illusion anyway. I can delay it another 5 years.
Let's talk about it being an illusion.
If it's true, it's not a big deal. It's not a big deal.
It is a big deal in your experience of it.
Yeah,
because do you want to experience all the drama? You know, the pain and the suffering. What do you want to experience? Peace. What is it you want?
She wants drama.
No, it's just not. This is not right or wrong. I mean, it's,
yeah, exactly.
We make some kind of a judgment here, but it's not really, actually. You can, it's a choice to be in that state.
And as long as you experience,
but do you want to be in drama and fear and pain and suffering? You want to be at peace. If you
I
get to choose.
Who wants drama and suffering?
It is a choice, really. It's not a judgment.
You are pain and drama because
you've
chosen.
Yes.
So
yes.
You want. If that's what I'm saying, it's because I think
it's not a choice, no, because it's unconscious.
Well, it's conscious now.
A lot of it.
For us, it's
conscious.
Yeah.
In but it's still different. It makes, I think, just when you come to the point when you realize, if you actually come to the point where you have the thought, okay, there is something that is the truth and it cannot be destroyed, and whatever I do, I can deny it, but that's it. That makes a big difference to me, at least.
Yeah.
Because okay, if I want another 500 years of drama, but okay, if you if that's what you like, but it's not a big deal because it's much less dramatic than if you believe like my God. If you truly believe that there is something that is eternal and that cannot be destroyed and that's your true being, then whatever you do, it's not so dramatic even with the drama because it's still just a temporary illusion you can play with, but it's not like the end of the, there's no end of this. It's not. It's very different, isn't it?
Yeah.
It makes
a big difference. I mean, it just does.
With the drama, that's the truth, okay, with the drama.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's a big difference.
It's a choice.
The ego,
kind of experience you want, really.
Yeah.
That's
it's not that I'm consciously choosing drama, but I am, on some level, I think, if this is true, as long as I experience the drama, it's because I have somehow chosen it. How else can I experience it? I must have chosen it. I must still choose it.
You find some use in the drama, maybe in the...
You gotta. It's when the willingness arises for the death of the drama.
Yeah, I mean, can you even? Is it like you say when the person is ready? Can you ever even force that? It will happen when it happens. Or can you?
Yeah, that's the
thing.
Yeah. Well, you know.
I think that going from A to B sometimes too fast. At least my experience is just it doesn't click.
Yeah. This is a fast group.
Yes.
Anyone who wants to.
I mean, if I was in this group, for example, 10 years ago, I was feeling really out of place,
and I. You would not come back. You see.
Exactly.
You would. Yeah, exactly.
I came the first day and say, "This is a very bunch of weird people." That's what.
Yeah.
That's what happened.
This
picture and these books and everything. Let's go with the car.
That
would have happened. That I can hear 10 years ago, honestly.
Since the start of this group, we've had many people come.
I went to see Moonji about 13 years ago. It was lovely. It was in this tiny room. It was a nice experience. But I don't think I got, what he was talking about. And yes, I wanted to go back, again, but I was not really crazy about going back either.
No.
So it was kind of fun.
But
there is a time, I think.
When I was 20 years old, I heard all these things, and there was something that really resonated with me in it. But still, you go around and then you go away, and then you come back, and then you go away, and go back.
That's okay.
That's my life is good. Because I can remember now when I was 20 years old, I read all this stuff. And it was not as already then I felt okay, I knew there was this is something here. But then I had to go and all this stuff. I had to go and then I come back and then I go and I come back and every time you come back, of course you have tried all the things of the world more and more, so you get more. Because when you're 20 years old you haven't tried that many things of the world yet. So you have to try it first and see. But already then I knew when I heard it this. I knew it, but I had still to try and go back. So every time you try and go back, you have tried. I've tried it all. You feel like you've tried all the different things, and then it's easy to come back again because you don't have to think maybe I should do this because you already tried it, you know what it can give or not. You have to kind of.
Of course, it's your free choice to try everything.
Yeah.
When you choose this group, where you're choosing.
I have tried many things already.
You can try the law. You can try the other groups for the slow lane.
Yeah, but I've tried many other things already now, so I cannot try all of it. So I'm kind of tired now.
You're tired of drama?
Yeah, I'm quite kind of tired. I'm dumb. I'm quite tired. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think I kind of no, but I think what still
was to keep silent.
What triggers me most is of course still fear about survival, like money, like this kind of physical thing. And I really try to a lot, like listening to lots of stuff with manifestation and stuff, where I try to believe I kind of feel like I do believe actually that everything is created by the mind. So when you trust or know that you will be taken care of, like you say, everything will just work out. It will. I think you will be taken care of if you can. But if you're fearful, because that's something I get hooked on. Oh, God.
So you
fearful.
You need
and
to
then about that thing, that was not romantic, but just not so romantic. I've never been a very romantic person. I'm not that type of person so much, but I mean still this thing with that kind of human love. I'm not like super romantic, but still like love a person, like human love. That's also hooked. Those two things I think are the most like.
You know, the hooking into those stories and the fear, you know, hooking into those stories and the fear, you know, this group is for, you know, this group really is for unhooking from that and experiencing your truth. The other groups, you know, if you want a romantic group, you know, teaching teaches you how to chase people and manifest.
Yeah, but
that's a different group. And, that's a different group. That's not this group.
Yeah, yeah, but I'm still what am I now still like? What is like hooking me in still?
Good, this is a good question.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So what hooking me in is that I can still feel the fear of, also physically, of course, fear of death, fear of the physical body.
Is this happening now? Is this here now?
Well, I'm here, it's a bit different because this is a different vibe here, so it's less here. Yeah. It's much less when you're here. When I'm here, it's
so
less.
You can enjoy the drama. you come here to just deflect for a while,
yeah,
so you can enjoy the drama
a
bit more.
The drama.
And then you come back, and then you come back next week after the drama is too much.
Let's use some beer.
Then you're going to try out a few more different drills. You're going to get some more and then come back here.
Yeah. Yeah.
A little bit less drama, but not completely drama less. See, 60% reduction in drama.
I go even to other groups where I try, and then I feel very conflicted because I try to achieve this or that. I cannot get it together properly. But I have been like that for many, since I was in my 20s, I've been like that. I've been switching on and off. For a while, I was completely into this mysticism, and I was thinking all this world is just drama, like you say. I was completely like, could almost feel like I can see the truth of it. I'm not going to go into this. And then a little bit later you feel like, oh, I still want these things, and then I switch and I start to go into how do you manifest this and this, and then you're like, yeah. I go into that and I pack up some lies.
Through the stuff as well.
Yeah, and then I don't succeed a little bit, not too much,
not
and then I give up, and I say, this doesn't give me much, and then you go back, okay, this is not it, and then you go back and then I go like back and forth, and every time you go back and forth, of course, every time you try to get satisfaction from the world, and you see what you can give and cannot give, then again, you feel like, no, it's like you have to exhaust yourself, some people do it quicker, some people do it longer. I suppose I take longer.
Yes.
This is like a 50% de-dramaing in the week, isn't it? Then you can pick it up.
But I think I'm closer to it now because I've tried so many times now, so I can't get one more exhausted.
I'm
afraid you get exhausted.
I get one more exhausted, so now I know that
it's going to be a good way to keep your drama going forever. You know, you just de-drama for one day in the week. And then go out there for the whole week and like let's take it all back. You know, it's like how can you fail even in a group with enlightenment for forever?
So what do you think? So you shouldn't try to. It's the wrong way is to try to make make your life work on that level to try to kind of get it the way you want it.
Are you willing to stop?
Huh?
Are you willing to stop?
To stop? What?
Well, I'm not willing, I'm just asking you a question.
Stop what?
Stop being willing?
To stop?
To stop what?
No. No, that's it.
To stop what? To stop what?
To stop thinking, for example. To stop.
No, we stop. That's it. Finished.
To stop what?
Stop.
I don't know what you mean.
Shh,
I mean,
no.
You sound like
too
my
much.
Friend at home. Stop, stop, stop. Quiet, quiet. Rest now. Sleep, sleep. Stop, quiet. Mm. There's always something coming up.
No, 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 no,
no,
it's coming
up. No,
it's not anything.
I have to get coming
no,
up.
No.
Of course,
no.
I have. You're still alive. You have to do something. No. I don't understand.
So
I don't understand. At least I crazy some off the stage. No, I cannot stop.
See how much better this feels.
No, it feels like there's something that feels like it has to do.
You know that something
yeah.
is
deceiving. I understand. There's
something,
not
something, but you
can't help it. Yeah.
That's not,
like,
that's
like
not
my mother. You're like my mother. You're my mother. She can't stop.
We can't help you.
It's great. I don't want my mother to take exercise. She can't be a
sweetie. She's not willing to stop. I'm fine with that. That's the question.
I don't think I understand what it means. Stop.
Just let it stop.
Stop thinking.
Stop thinking.
Not
for example, yeah. Stop thinking.
Stay in the moment. Stay in silence
yeah.
in the moment.
You can do this for a while after a while. You have to get bored of it.
No, you don't have to. Do anything. You don't have to.
Why it's wrong to think, actually.
That's thinking. So you just stay in silence. You see, the longer you stay in silence, the easier it gets. The temptation to...
Not to think. You don't need to think, you mean. I thought you needed to think to function.
It's not the needing to think. It's don't pay attention to the thoughts. if somebody...
They come and go. Sorry.
Yeah, they come and go. If somebody walks in the room and walks out, there's no need to pay attention. If there's no attention to anyone walking in and out of the room, then it's not even noticed. If it's not noticed...
You have dysfunction in your life to stop what you have to plan. Don't you have to plan what I'm going to do, what I'm going to do now, for example, when the...
You are able to function. You are able. In fact, you are much able to function.
To make
because
decisions.
If you are at peace,
make decisions. This is how it's going to go. Don't you have to plan for the future, what am I going to do in the summer?
You're doing that
example.
From a place of peace. You're
you
doing
think,
that from a totally different
yeah.
place too.
You think, for example, 90% of the time, if you manage to change that to 10%, you use this 10% to make decisions. But you don't have to be thinking
think
all the time, being
much.
Like, you know what I mean?
So if you think too much, it will more hinder you than help you, you mean?
I mean, because thinking creates its own
yeah.
energy.
There's a flow state.
Exhausting.
There's a flow state when the thinking you is gone.
And you don't have... That's what I maybe don't trust, that if you don't have to think, you will still be able to make decisions and function.
Your ego
well.
Won't be making the decisions. Anymore.
Something else that is better will make
yes.
decisions.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But
yeah.
you have to
yeah.
give... You as
so you mean you can't give up? You don't even have to think, you mean? You don't have to plan.
The thinker is gone. Because the thinker is the ego.
But no, let's take a very concrete example that I can ask them. Because for now, for example, so where I'm living now, the contract runs out in June, beginning of June, and they will ask me already, I know, in the end of March, do you want to renew the contract? But I don't think I can do it again, it's too expensive. So now I think, what am I going to do? Where am I going to go? Where am I going to live? How should I, what am I going to do for the future now? Don't I have, how do I make these kind of decisions? So today I'm talking to my friend and I told him, what do you want to do? Should we go to another country? Blah, blah, blah. I mean, shouldn't you talk about these things? Should you just blank your mind out? I mean, how do you handle these practical things?
It's not a black and white thing, you know? No. You can think 90% of the time, or you can think 10% of the time, which is the necessary to make certain decisions. Mm. You need, you don't need to be thinking 90% of the time, you know what I mean?
Mm. Yeah, but it's really practical, so how do you do that? And you just try to keep a blank mind?
No, I mean, these are different levels of consciousness. You see, you can never be free, because always these thoughts will come to play.
It is practical things in life, that decisions you have to make and all that. How do you handle that in a practical level?
I think you can still, make those kind of decisions, but you're making those decisions from a totally different place within yourself, from a place of peace, from a place of surrender, from a place, you still make those decisions, but it's a totally different place. We don't need to be consumed by this, endless thinking, endless worry, endless drama, endless, that is the difference for me, we don't have to, because most of our time is taken up by this, the worry, the drama, the thinking, you can still, kind of really guide to make those decisions, but we do it from a place of peace, from a place of serenity, from a place of, that's one level. I think Sabir talks about a totally, there is a much higher level to this. But, this is for me, it's a practical. But that's it's a practical for me as well. It's just almost, you make those, you pray, you kind of stay at peace, you kind of ask for guidance, and you make those decisions. That on one level, there's another higher level too. But that is one level that can be quite practical too. It's just most of the times we get totally consumed. I think that's
that's
the problem. From the drama, the thinking, the worrying, the struggle, So in effect, we do not make effective decisions.
No.
Because we make decisions out of worry, out of, whatever. Yeah. So I think, sorry, Sabir.
No, it's okay. I mean, it's correct. Everything is like
that is really
level.
my
Well, you notice that you get all this worrying sort of, because I can see clearly that that's not helpful to get caught up in all this worrying at all.
So you can see, for example, your tendency to talk or your tendency to think, and you say, okay, I see this tendency, instead of just thinking,
You don't want to get hooked in the thinking. You want to have it detached. Your thinking is meaningless. It's not interesting.
Even when it's thought about what am I going to do for the future, what decisions am I going to make, when you feel like you have to take decisions,
you practice the same, so when it comes, you can just say stop.
But how do you make the decisions? How do you make the decisions?
Something
you have to make a decision.
The same thing that makes you breathing in your heartbeat.
So you just wait until it's just at the end of the line, you have just...
The brain is getting confused because you're now out of answers, and so it's like, it has to have something to hold on to. But even that's not true. Because when you know yourself to be the source of all these things that appear, and the love that's underneath everything, this question will
not exist. But something will take care of you and fix it up.
Which is you. You takes care of you, like, in a higher sense. So these questions will not exist. And these fears will not exist. When you really drop into you, the real you.
I suppose it's about trust in you.
Yes. 100% trust. 100% surrender.
Yeah.
Forget it. forget the thinking. And then something else will be in charge.
And I understand you. I'm also quite anxious and jumpy, so I can understand this energy of thinking, of worrying, of wanting to talk.
Yeah.
I have this tendency all the time, so but I try to... But if I was, you know, letting this energy out, I would be...
Yeah.
So I understand
it's
this energy of,
really.
Of thinking, because it's in me.
You don't touch your thing, you have to fix everything.
Yeah, so I totally relate to that tendency.
It's observed. It's not you. It's meaningless. And it can be safely experienced through. If you grab it, if you identify with the fear or the thoughts, then that becomes the seeming you, the illusory you. And that has to plan.
I think it is like you feel like the mind has to take care of you because there's nothing else.
Not
so the mind has to take care of you.
Yes.
Because if
you
have to
trust that there's
nothing.
More.
Yeah, exactly.
No.
Exactly.
Do you
that's
know
the
it's
thing.
Not the real
you? So, I mean, the group is about, this group is, the deep intention is the death of that. Not needed. Other groups have a different intention, but this group is like, let it go. And trust.
Yeah, I think that's the only solution. I mean, I was just exhausting. You have to find
good.
That other trust. I mean,
when
I
there's 100% exhaustion and fed up with this, it doesn't matter. You let everything go. Let the future go. Let the bills go. When when there's complete exhaustion and it's fed up, then it's good. You let it go. What happens? Then you have to trust. Complete trust.
Yeah, I think that's the only way. In the end, that's the only you have in the way.
So which year do you want to do it?
Which way?
What year do you want to do it? Like,
what?
In which year do you want to let go?
Which year? I don't know. I mean, I'm sorry.
Like 15 years time, maybe?
No, it's like this year.
That's it.
Oh, it's been a major step, really, actually.
Well, get it to this year. We've got 12 months.
No. It's just within the last kind of couple of weeks, I've noticed.
You think so?
For me?
Yeah.
I haven't seen me up in that.
I'm reading, you know, yes, that book, you can't come to the place to experience it, even momentarily.
That's really important, I think.
Even momentarily, to experience that bigness.
You can forget it and re-identify very easily into the world. It might be. Sometimes they become implosions, but they can be like aha moments, and then there's extreme re-identification with the world to forget it as quickly as possible. And make as many stories, and then it can be quite easily forgotten as well in the chase of drama. But when there's, when there's total fed upness, if the exhaustion is exhausting enough, if the drama has been enough, if another search for another on another trail is too much, then naturally one comes to the point of being willing to surrender 100% totally, not another goose chase.
What happens when you die, then, even if you're not like in red dim consciously when you're like alive, but at the moment of death, wouldn't it? I think I asked you this once before, actually, that wouldn't that...
On the moment of the physical body dying,
yeah.
One is the experience of one's consciousness at that point. So if one is heavily identified, then one will remain heavily
you
identified.
Just say like that, you would like reincarnate.
Yeah.
Something,
and if you're in the true state, then there's no need to reincarnate because one is the eternal. Hence the thing of Buddha saying there's only one escape from reincarnation, and that's enlightenment. That's the only escape for you to recognize the truth of who you are. Otherwise, you're always in identification, you're always in chasing, you're always in the loop of drama. Drama after drama after drama. No, the donut will fix me. No, this man will fix me. No, that man will fix me. No, this movie will fix me. No, that book will fix me. Lifetime after lifetime after lifetime. Until something gets exhausted by it and says, now is the time for something to be experienced. The end of this. Finito. So that's those are all the awakened teachers. It's enough. No, another drama. No, it's enough now. Now let me try another drama. You know,
let
so.
Try another drama.
So then when the trust is there, it's fine. You know, the universe, the true you, it takes care of everything. But you know, something wants to say no. Let me keep going.
You are not convinced yet. That's why, right? You're still not convinced. You still think there's another way. You have to try it all. I think many. I am like that. At least I have to try everything. Okay, no, there's not that. And finally, we are okay. I'm satisfied now. I've tried it all. I give up. But I never give up easily. I have to try everything before I give up.
I secretly feel like I should say to you, like, why don't you try everything else and then come here?
I have tried most things. I think I've tried almost everything. That's why I'm even coming here at all. Maybe not every. Maybe I haven't tried more things.
Then go try those ones. After you've tried everything, come back.
I don't know what else I can try. I think I've tried everything.
Are you ready to surrender?
I've come to that stage too. I have tried over the last 30 years many things. Trust me, I've tried everything. Thousands of workshops, seminars, methods I've done. Yes, so I know what you're talking about.
You've tried everything, like everything.
I think most of us do anyway, yeah.
It's not much more, you're not really excited about trying this or that. Okay, I've tried that already. You know that. You can give us something a little bit, but it's not what you want, really. So somewhere, you know, somehow that is not
good.
Really what you want.
And when this is clear, then just stay in presence. If any fear or any thought arises, either silence it or just see what is observing that. Or just connect to the presence that is here. Because when you identify, you just prolong the drama. Every identification in the moment is prolonging drama, the life of drama. When the drama is not fed with identification for enough time, then the timeless, eternal presence, and then the eternal love is experienced. And then the flow state, the state where the universe takes care of its own. No you is required. You don't need to think about it.
I think the difference is like for you, for example, and people you read about, it's like they have experienced, even people have told me about when they take drugs, and sometimes they feel this love, they feel this universal love, this very strong experience. And when you've experienced that, I think it's different, because I've never really experienced that in that way. I have experienced something a little bit like, but not strong enough for me to be that convinced about it. Because I know that many years ago, when I had quite a strong like change in my life, when I was in a very bad place, and then I've been looking into all the stuff, and then I was starting to read the Bible, Christian Bible, and of course I'm brought up in Sweden, and it's like when I was a child, it was still like the state and the church was still like one, so you had to, basically you were brought up in the church, even if you weren't really religious, you would all get all, and I think we're still in a Christian, in the West we're still a Christian, in all countries are still influenced by that, so you have that in the back of your mind, but I hadn't really related to it consciously myself, so I started to read when I was in my 20s, to read the Bible myself, you know, as an adult, consciously. And I was like, wow, it really touched me, really. I think I was in a specific state that I could take it in a way that I couldn't take it either before or after. That I really felt like there was some liberating message in it, and it touched me on a deep level. And then after that, there was many things happening, and then I was a very bad place. I was completely, horribly, my life was very dramatic. And then I felt this really like an experience, a kind of spiritual experience, really. I felt like, I can see it just now, it's more like a memory, and I think now I would see it differently, but I still remember I felt this thing, it was the first time in my life I felt like there is love, and I just knew it, it was like there is love, and it was not like this you, this type of somebody, I just knew there is love, and I still remember that feeling, and there was something inside me I had never felt before, I exist. I never. It was so weird. It was like my heart, almost also connected in the body to the heart. I felt like I am. I never felt like I was there before, but now I feel I am here, and I know there is love even though I could feel how, I felt so unworthy, so bad, but then I thought there was somebody, and for me, then it was in the Christian symbolism, like, Christ has died, all this stuff. I'm not like, I've never called myself a Christian or anything like that, but I could feel this thing that, for me at that time, it was some meaning to that when I say that Jesus has died for you, you're like a sinner, you're bad, but Jesus has died for you, and you're like, and that has saved you. And for me, that had a specific meaning. I still remember it. I felt so bad. I felt like the most unworthy, horrible person. And then I felt like there was someone.
You could say the sin is your identification with thoughts and the body and fear.
What? Not sin?
Sin.
Yeah. But then it was like there was this love that I was bigger than that, and it was like a concrete experience. It was not intellectual. It was nothing. I couldn't deny it. It was just washing over. It was just bigger, and there was no way I could...
So would you trade your ego for that?
Yeah, it was not even so. I mean, that was so amazing. So of course you would. You wouldn't.
Okay,
even,
so
oh,
this is
that.
So
that was so far long ago. Now I forgot about. Yeah, but no. Then after that, I felt love for a person. You know, feel love. And that's also
no,
real. No,
it's not. That's not real. Love,
yeah, it's real. Also, it's the same. Love is just a mind, the form of it. I feel it's love. It's the same. It's love.
No, it's not the same.
It's
love.
Not okay.
It's not. Because that love is universal. It's not special.
It's not special, but it's the same
But it's not,
love.
No, it's a lower order.
Right.
It's a lower order.
But love is love, there's just different...
well, there's different levels, yes,
levels.
Yeah,
yeah,
yes, yes, okay.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Because that's the problem, that's why you're still in the drama. Because of identified special love. That's why I'm pointing it out to you. is the whole point of that Jesus love is not to them.
That is not special, of course. That was just love.
That's the universal, yes. That's the universal love. And then the ego has to hijack it and then project it onto one person and then say that this is the fantasy love, and you trade the universal love for...
Oh, it's not so much that, because when I feel love towards one person, it's not so much because I feel even then that it's not about the person, it's just the person. It's just a trigger for me to connect with the love in me.
Okay, well, this is good.
I know that every moment is not about a person, it's just a trigger. I know that, wow, now I can get that.
She awakens something in you.
I know it's always my love, it's my love, it's I am the one. Because like when he said in this book, he said that he realized that first he thought I'm happy when I am loved, but he realized no, he was not happy when he was loved, it didn't help him. But when he was loving, he was happy. And that's how I feel. This person triggers the love in me, so I can feel my love, and it's like the love in me that is the happiness, not the person. The person is just somebody who's an excuse for me to feel
this
love.
Is
the problem. But then I think I think you're right, person. Yes, it's something, you know, the other person awakens that. But the problem after that is the ego gets, you know, kind of almost like somehow in the way, and, you know, create this special kind of love for this person, or we get attached to this person.
But I know
suddenly,
it's not about that
this
person.
Without this person, I cannot be happy. Love is going to go without this person, so we attach.
I know that love is in me.
Love is
in me. The person cannot make me love. The person is just my excuse to connect with the love. The love is inside. It's like your love always. It's like...
But in order to connect to the love eventually, all specialness... In order to connect to the universal love, all special love has to be forsaken. Because otherwise you're just going to be... And I think for some people, I mean, the notion of special love is so strong, you know, that it actually can lead to the opposite of love. It leads to addiction.
But if you are connected to love on a deeper level, so you cannot have any special love.
No, I mean, no, relationships happen, but they're not special. They're non-attached.
Yeah. Yeah. They're, so you don't feel more love for that person than for anybody else?
No. So, you know, seemingly, to an outside person, you may have a romantic... It looks like a romantic relationship, but it's not a special relationship.
What would it be like then for the person then?
It'll be amazing. Because you'll be in that love.
Yes,
you'll be in that love all the time with everyone. But you have maybe
romantic. But if you still have
a special
relationship, how would that be then if you love everyone the same? How can you still
because God is
married to someone?
Because God is
very difficult with that. It is difficult, absolutely it's difficult, but I think it is possible, you know, a lot of people. But that is, you know, I think that is the ultimate, you know, for me. And that is, you know, that is so beautiful, because you are with the other person, but you don't, attach your happiness on the other person. The other person is not your source of, peace or happiness and joy.
No, but I get that. I
it's
mean, that
just,
I get,
you know,
yeah,
it's just
right.
Yeah.
It'll be even
beauty.
Better. It'll be even better than having attachment.
It's difficult, you know.
Yeah, but I mean, I get that completely even now that I don't even believe that anybody else can make me happy. That I'm clear about, but still I can still attach to all this stuff, but I don't believe in that. I can see how it can trigger my love for a person, and I can feel love for that person more than for others, and that can be real in itself. But I don't believe that is... I can see the level of that. That is very clear to me, actually. I don't believe in that as some kind of savior for me or that that is the truth. I really don't believe in anymore. Definitely not still. I am attached to it because I can still feel that. But I don't...
Are you willing to let it go?
What would that mean, not let it go?
It means not creating an attachment.
He doesn't mean that, you know, I think...
Yeah,
sorry.
But I don't think...
sorry, Monica, I don't think he means you're giving up the relationship, right? He doesn't mean that. It sounds as if he... It means just letting go of all the other, you know...
I don't feel I have the control over that, actually, to give up the attachment. I can feel I am super attached to this guy I'm living with now.
No, I mean,
but that's what he Sabir suggested.
You
go to this place.
If you're willing to let the attachment go, you can let it go.
Would you do that?
That's what we do here every week, letting attachments go. everything we do and every word and every lesson we do letting go of attachment. Self-inquiry, all the lessons. Cancelling beliefs.
Forgiveness. I think someone will actually call something different to make it more clear.
For me, it's almost like sometimes I just feel like I
doesn't
give up.
Say.
I just did this seriously, just recently, a few days ago. Fed up with everything. I'm just fed up with everything. I just almost feel like I'm fed up with this life completely. I'm just tired of all the shit. I mean, it's not. I feel so fed up, but that's not it. I mean, to be fed up with it.
If you're fed up, then you would listen to what I'm telling you every week. Okay. So you have to go through these things. Come up like fed up with the world, fear, terror, loneliness. All of these things arise in stages, and it's like I'm sharing. You know, something is observing fed upness, which is bigger than fed upness, because fed upness is like a. It's like a wave of some emotion coming in, but something has observed that.
Frustration, I suppose.
Frustration comes in. Now a big wave of frustration comes in, but then something is watching. Connect to the presence, the bigger now that in which this is contained.
The beingness.
The beingness.
Yeah.
Then something wants to die, but this is also being experienced in the beingness. Terror comes up, and there's a habitual wanting to make a story and hook into the terror of the death.
Die anyway, and then it would be given up.
Yeah.
I mean, you die and it's gone.
You want to die highly identified with your ego. You want your physical body to go,
you
and
die,
you still
have to
be.
Give it up
the point of peace and happiness forever.
When you die,
anyway.
When you die, it goes. Everything goes. The people go, the world.
Look, you're this is also being observed. All of this that we're talking about.
I mean, then the control itself.
Look, you're not. You want to make up 100 answers and questions, and apart from doing it, so you're not fed up. You see, I'm showing you the method to be free, and yes. I'm agreeing with you. Fed upness comes, frustration comes, fear of death comes.
But
what
I mean, when
question...
you die, it will go. even if you haven't managed to let go of it before, it will go automatically when you die, won't it?
Why don't you find the eternal truth now? Why wait to see? We can talk about exactly what happens when the physical body dies. But I would suggest that if you want... It's preferable not to be highly identified with your ego at the point of the physical body dropping off than to be free when the physical body is preferable than to wait, you know, and say, well, I'll just be in drama until the physical body drops. And then let's see what happens later on.
Well, I almost feel like because I'm already like kind of getting a little bit what it's about, so when the body everything goes, I was like, okay, let's go now.
Okay, so what
I feel like I'm just waiting for an excuse.
So you want a little bit of drama until the physical body
dies.
Yeah,
so when I will wait until I die, and then I will. Okay, now it's over. Let's go.
And then you're going to do the work in the other realm.
No, but then
you want to do the work in the other realm.
I drop it all. At the dying moment, I will just drop it all.
No, that's not the easy thing. Yeah.
I don't think that. Yeah, no.
No.
If you are not prepared, you know, when you are dying, you're going to be scared instead of at peace. Because you have all the ego.
You might get reincarnated again.
Yes.
But you failed the test.
Yes.
You go back again. You'd be a little baby again, chasing things for another life.
There are no shortcuts.
Everybody's focused on me now since I came here.
There are no shortcuts.
Let's talk about something else except how to be free.
But you know what's so beautiful? It's just, you know, that old spirit, you know, directed you to that book.
I
think there is no accident.
I haven't finished it.
No, but I don't think you should finish the book.
No. Yeah.
I am going to read it more. I like it.
Yeah, it was going to
get better. What
am I
reading?
You know, it's not
that. No, we are joking.
It's a good story. You know.
I love reading too.
Yeah,
you know, what I'm trying to say is, you know, it's quite interesting what spirit shows us. You know, spirit directed you to have that kind of experience of what Sabir is talking about, the bigness, this, you know. So obviously there is a reason that you've been directed to this book, and obviously there is a reason you're here, and we are here.
I thought it was not even a point to come in this place, and I mean, all this stuff coming.
So, but it is, you know, we are, it's not, you know, it's not an accident. I don't believe there are
accidents. No. Something wants to hold on to the drama.
And that's fine, I think, too.
It's okay.
You know, it's fine.
Yeah.
But you know what? Drama is tiring. It's exhausting.
Yes.
It's, you know, isn't that the life we want, really? Full of drama.
Fear is the
and
love.
Fear.
I hate as a working
of
fear.
All of them,
love.
You know, it's just kind of a bundle of different...
So things
that go along with the ego, really.
It's a group, it's like how to transcend all of this and be free. This group is A Course in Miracles. For me, it's releasing all the blocks,
yeah,
every single block that stands in the way,
yeah,
in the recognition of eternal truth and love. Everything that stands in the way.
Yeah,
if you want to go to in a Tai Chi class, that's a different group, you see. But this group is about freedom. Freedom from all suffering, freedom from all bondage. So it's an anti-drama group.
Anti-drama. You
can
call it the anti-drama group.
Yeah, we're not about anti-drama. It's not really a book club either, this group, about how many books we can read in the week. It's about freedom, experiencing freedom and being freedom. But you know, it's also for people to bring it, for those habitual tendencies to drama and to victimhood and to stories and to the future and to the past, for all of those to be exposed in this setting so that freedom can take root. So that the group is for the truth to be recognized, the freedom. And I think, you know, as has been shared in this group, most people have had those glimpses of those experiences. Otherwise, no one comes here by accident.
Yeah.
You know, something may want to go to a Tai Chi class afterwards, or I don't know.
Combined too.
Or history lessons, or a drama school, or I don't know. But this one is for freedom, in this particular group. And in my experience, nothing is better than freedom. I mean, as has been shared, how many more dramas is required? So, you know, the great fear at the end of it, you know, if you give up, also to transcend the great fear can be transcended. That's the fear. You allow the fear to come up, and then you see what's observing the fear. Let the fear run. Don't run away into identification. And then you'll see that it will dissolve, and yet you will still remain.
Mm.
When this is witnessed, that you allow it to be there, and then slowly dissolve, and the eternal, that which remains eternally, is then your resting place, is confirmed. That's the last confirmation.
You see that it's always there, whatever happens.
Whatever happens. It's that for most genuine spiritual seekers, it comes up at one point.
Like, I love this. I used to read when I was very, very fearful and panicking when I used to read the Bible. It was this, in the Psalms in the Bible, 139, so there, it's quite a long thing, and I said, for example, if I go to the end of the earth or whatever, God will still hold me. It's like there was no end. If I say, I don't know what it says in English, but in Swedish, like, if I say night will cover me and everything, you will still be there.
That's right.
Like, wherever I go, there will no way I can get out of this.
That's right.
It was such a wonderful thing. I would read it when I was really sick, but I would read it out loud to myself all over. It's very, very... It says that in a way. It's like, there's no way I cannot get out of this, whatever I try to do. If I even say it, everything is darkness around me. If I go, there's no way I can get out of this. It's like when you say that, it will always be there, whatever you do.
Yeah. Like, I think, was it, even though I walk in the valley of death?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, you know, that's something else. That is the...
Never heard
it. That is the other one, yeah. That is the Lord is my shepherd, isn't that?
Yeah.
But there's one 139, Psalm 139 is a bit different also, but that's wonderful song.
But all of those, you see, are methods to get us out from, you know, those dramas to the place of peace. This is really a tool. Those are tools, really.
Yeah.
For me, the prayers are tools, really, to get you to that place.
And written by people who experience
it,
and that is help. Because I think when someone speaks to you from that place, you feel it when you read it, because you feel the place they were in when they wrote it, and that's why it's helpful.
Yes.
It's the same with the Course in Miracles, suppose that text. It's like whatever is written from that place, when the person writes it, you will feel it when you read it. You will kind of get
the vibration.
So are you ready to be in that now? Are you in that one? Do you want to be free? When do you want to be free?
Tomorrow.
That's the, you know, so when you know, because freedom can only happen now. It can never happen if it's tomorrow. As long as it's tomorrow, it can never happen.
Exactly.
And as long as there is a wanting of more drama, it can never happen as well.
Maybe she's able to do like 10% of the... That's
10%.
You know what I mean? What we were discussing the other day, remember?
Yes.
For me, it does make sense because, again, it's go from 0 to 100 very quickly.
Absolutely.
I don't see that. It would be really nice, but.
No, everybody has got their own pace, absolutely.
You have your emotion and you know, that intense emotion,
I think so. I think this, the willingness there doesn't really matter in my view, that your pace.
In the end, there's only one way, I think. There's only one exit here. There's only one exit.
This is like
fire. It's just a question of how long it will take. There's only one exit.
Yes.
But maybe your maximum at one moment is 10%, and for you, that means giving all your heart into it.
Yes.
Maybe that sounds a bit, you know, like stepping back, but I don't know, for me...
I think it's...
You know, just a 10% can be a lot, because 10% and then another 10% and then another 10%.
10% is a lot. I'm not against doing it slowly. It's just that I see my role, if people come to this group, is to facilitate it at the maximum rate allowable.
Mm.
You know, whatever it is whatever it is.
Mm.
But it's like if I accept that people came here for some reason, and God has a wiser plan beyond even my knowing or anybody's knowing. So if they're here, I mean, you know, my teachers are Muji and Enlightenment. So anyone who comes here, it's not going to be. It's going to happen at the rate it's going to happen.
Yeah.
But this isn't, you know, the teachers I have are not about, let's take 300 years to slowly go there.
So that's the way you feel to do it, no? It's like,
well, that's the way I, it's intuitive in every moment. What happens is what happens.
Yeah, yeah.
With some people, it feels like that's the way it needs to be quick, because the ego's too clever. In some individuals, and it's trying to, you know, if it feels like the ego is always trying to delay freedom, it's trying to be very clever, then one has to be quite clear.
Yeah,
if someone is like sincere, they will, you know, then sometimes I'm a bit more slow, because it's like like they want it, so they'll be coming, but they'll get it. But if it's like there's massive avoidance, you know, or the ego's trying to play games.
Yeah.
Then it's like one has to like try and catch the ego, you know, and confront the ego. So it varies, it shifts. It's like my experience with each individual is different. Because it seems, you know, it just comes naturally to be slightly different with different individuals. And if a perception of a game is being played, then, you know, it seems sometimes that one has to try and illuminate what the game is, you know, because sometimes this game can be unconscious or conscious, but then it has to be like, it feels like something wants to expose what's going on, you see. So it varies from individual to individual. Also, it's not, you know, if a person has been experiencing it for a long time, there seems to be a capacity to be more advanced or to try and expose things a bit more clearly. If someone's brand new, you know, there'd probably be a slightly different interaction with a brand new, they'd never heard of anything. So it varies. But sometimes, you know, there's a different experience with each individual. It's not the same. I wouldn't like necessarily try and be very, very direct with someone brand new to the whole thing on the first day, unless there seemed to be a readiness for that automatically. But emoji is very much about getting it. You can get it now.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
It's not. You know, he doesn't really take.
No.
Let's talk about it. Let's talk about it. For
he's got, I went to this 5-day thing with him in
Oxford.
Was it? Yeah, it was a couple of years ago. It was quite amazing. It actually, I hadn't planned it at all. It was just someone I knew suddenly the day before. So sent me a message over Skype. You have to go to this thing. I got yourself this in me. I have to tell you this, and I just quickly got done.
Oh, you were there for 5 days.
I
went there for the same time.
I was there.
It must have been the same time.
But before I even went to it. Were you also there?
Yeah, it was
a year or two ago.
A couple of years ago.
Yeah. I was there last this time and the year before.
I think the year before I was there as well.
Well, I have only been there once. It must have been quite a long time ago.
Maybe it was 3 years.
Maybe 2 years ago. Maybe
2 years. 2 years, the whole lot of us were there.
Yeah.
Oh, well, we were all there.
Yes, obviously we were there. We didn't know each other.
I knew about him before. I heard some videos of him a little bit. I listened a lot, but I knew about him already. But I hadn't planned at all to go, and it was just somebody who told me that a day or so before, and I just quickly decided to go. And it was really still, it was quite fascinating, I must say. I really felt like it was something about that, oh shit, am I going to sit there for 5 hours? But it was like you just got hooked by, it was so, and you we sit there and you hear what's going on. It was really amazing, actually, I must say. Because it's like, it's so, every person talks to you, like what's happening in that encounter with it. Like you say, you talk different to different people. Or something is happening in the moment there with that person, what they say. It was really fascinating.
But he is, I think to be just right, and that's Captain Max, but he's very direct.
But he
wants you to be enlightened now.
That's what I was thinking, because he might be right direct, but not, some people might be like almost provocative direct in a harsh way, but he's not at all, it's not at all harsh or direct in a hard way. It was very gentle in a way, I find. He's not harsh.
He's not harsh, but he's very direct.
Yeah, but not in this harsh. Because I think some teachers can be maybe more provocative and maybe more harsh. But I did. That's how I experienced him. But not direct in a way that I feel like provocative or harsh. He was very.
I think of the teachers of Enlightenment, I think he's probably the most direct.
He's loving.
But loving, exactly. He's very loving and very gentle.
But he's kind of, he wants you there. So. I mean, that's, you know, I think I find, for me, it's too,
I think of all
you know, for me,
for me too.
I find that, for me, in a way, it's just...
Of all the teachers I'm aware of, he's the most direct.
Yeah. It's very different. His style is very different.
Yeah. That's very different.
The message is different. But I think Muji, definitely.
But I think about that he's so loving, so you don't experience, because some people I can experience like they kind of, you call it direct, and I feel like shit, they're kind of you almost feel like
harsh.
But I didn't find that with him at all. He felt very loving and gentle in a way, even if you're direct, but if you are direct, but still it's very different to me. Because that's how I think some teachers, and you feel they're not loving, and that really, maybe I'm not just my limitations, it doesn't allow me to feel their love, but I just feel that is like, no. Because there's no, for me it's all about love, and if there's no love, I don't give a shit. I think the truth for me, there is love. If there's no love, it's not true. I don't believe in it. I don't care even if I say it's true. I don't care if there's no love. I don't care. I don't care even if it's the truth. I don't. There has to be that love somehow. And what is that? How do you know what that is? That's just something you know or not. Or maybe, I don't know. At least that's what I go for. I go for that. If I feel I have love, I will listen. If I don't have love, I don't listen. I don't care. Because I don't want it anyway. Even if it promised me freedom, if I don't feel there's love, I don't care about the freedom.
Do you still listen to Muji?
No, I don't listen to anyone. Really,
but if you find him that he's very loving and all, what stops you?
Oh, I don't remember even.
There's not enough drama in Muji.
No drama.
It's not a good story.
Say go into within yourself. He says,
yeah, he brings it back to this
space. It's not about me, it's about you.
But he really brings it back to the moment, to your own experience.
Yeah.
He brings it back to your own experience. In that scale, you don't have to believe anything. What is your experience in this moment?
Yeah.
Everything you can know is like what you hear, what you sense, what you see.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really basic.
It's not into the adoration of, you know, the person or whatever.
Yeah, that's
none of this, you know, none of this, you know, adoring, you know, the guru or. He's
not at all. Just like your experience.
So long because I went on a retreat, you know, for a week, and really, you know, it's just kind of very, very humble, very, very lovely, very lovely.
You see,
totally different.
I'm the best one, though.
Very.
I have watched him in YouTube, so I'm curious.
Have you watched?
Yeah.
He would sit and with everyone, he would eat and you know, he would chat and very humble, very normal.
Yeah,
right.
Normal.
That's what I love.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah.
So normal.
So
yeah.
Too normal.
Too very normal. Yeah, very normal. He's got a presence there.
Yeah.
He's normal. I think Moody is different.
He's different style.
But that's also what people make of them. People want someone
to
work.
That's what people make of people.
They want them to be this. That's the thing. Often, like people want, they come and then, and they want them to be this God almost.
Yes.
That's often what people put on them.
People have to fight.
Yes, because even Moody, I remember after this
thing,
I think he said, come up, you don't have to do it. Like, people come and
he
didn't even want them to do
that. Apparently, that's what Sabir was saying, that he doesn't actually encourage
people. No, he doesn't.
But actually, that's what you're saying, I don't know. But actually people,
they want
maybe because of his whole persona, is the guru thing, the Indian thing. Maybe that's
wrong.
That's
why he dresses.
That's why this Rupert Spire is just
normal.
Maybe that's what
that
it is, his whole persona.
Yeah.
Just the way he dresses, the way he eats.
Which sometimes dress all in white.
People are kind of going, even if he doesn't encourage them, kind of fulfill. I've been to India, it's a big thing going to the, a couple of times, the feet of the guru. I mean, my God, you can really, it could easily be almost accidents, they know. Really, people run, to go and go. It's a big thing. So it's a kind of really that tradition.
I was just saying, we were just talking about that today with a friend, actually, about India. We're going to India. I said, never been to India. I said, I've heard that people say that if you've never been, it's like culture shock, and it's so different. So
it's very, very different. I've been there twice, it's beautiful. Very beautiful, actually. Yeah. Yeah, very, very beautiful and interesting.